have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before. Yes, the world behind me, the cross before me. The world behind me, the cross before.
Welcome back to Virtual Chapel this week. We've been going through the Gospel according to John. And this week we're going to be finishing up John chapter 1, starting in verse 38. Last week we saw Jesus' preparation for his ministry as he was baptized by John the Baptist. And this week we're going to look at Jesus calling his first disciples. And so basically each Gospel account, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they have their own perspective on how Jesus called the disciples because they weren't all called at the same time. So we get a fresh perspective here in John. So today we're going to be looking at John's perspective and how he saw Jesus calling his first disciples. Let's look at, well, before I do that, let me just open us up in a word of prayer. Father God, we just thank you for the sunshine and the weather that you provided us for us this weekend. We just pray that you will continue to offer your protection upon us, Father God, and people around the world who are suffering right now. Father, I pray that you come to their rescue. I just thank you that you offered the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world for us, Father God, for our sins. I just pray that that more and more we will more diligently seek you and your will for our lives. And I would just ask for more and more of your spirit to be present with us. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. So let's look at verse 38. That's where we're going to start today. Actually, back up to verse 35. I'm sorry, 35. It says, "The following day, John was again standing with two of his disciples. As Jesus walked by, John looked at him and declared, 'Look, there is the Lamb of God.' When Jesus' two disciples heard this, they followed Jesus." And so, we see that sometime shortly after, or we don't know how much time passed between Jesus' baptism and him calling his disciples, John the Baptist sends two of his disciples away to become basically disciples of Jesus. Remember that John the Baptist was a superstar, and he had all of this following of disciples who were following him out in the desert. And so, but today we see him send away these two disciples. And these two disciples are Andrew and John, the son of Zebedee. John is the author of the Gospel according to John. Don't get confused by the two Johns we're talking about, John the Baptist and John, who will later become the apostle who wrote this gospel. So we see that John the Apostle was one of John the Baptist's disciples. So the author of this account was once a disciple of John the Baptist. For one rabbi or a teacher to send away his disciples to follow another rabbi or teacher was very unusual. Usually you wouldn't send your disciples to go follow another teacher. Normally when rabbis sent out his disciples, it was so that they could teach others. So you wouldn't send out your disciples to go follow another rabbi, you would send them out to become teachers. For John to send out his disciples to a greater person shows that John the Baptist, he had a lot of humility and a lot of wisdom. You know, he was a prophet of God. We call him the last of the Old Testament prophets. I'm sure it wasn't easy for him to send out these two disciples. I'm sure it wasn't an easy decision for him to do from a human perspective, but he knew who Jesus was. John tells his disciples that Jesus is the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sins of the world. And last week we talked about Jesus Christ being the Lamb of God, the Passover Lamb. As the Passover Lamb of God, Jesus is our once and for all sacrifice. And just to review a little bit, during the Passover, there was a time when the Israelites were enslaved inside of the land of Egypt, and God wanted to free his people out of Egypt. And so one of the last plagues that God put upon Egypt was the death of the firstborn son. And so what the Israelites were supposed to do was to sacrifice a spotless lamb and put that blood on the doorpost. And when the angel of the Lord would pass through Egypt, he would pass over their houses and only affect the houses of the Egyptians. And this would eventually lead to Israel being able to leave Egypt and regain their freedom. John the Baptist is telling us that that was a foreshadowing of what was to come in for us spiritually through the sacrifice that Jesus was going to make for us on the cross. Jesus was the spotless Passover Lamb of God. He was sinless. Even though he was like us in all ways, he faced temptation. He never sinned. And so he was perfect. And he was without blemish. And so his sacrifice on the cross was for us to be reconciled back to Father God again. God was rescuing us from sin and shame and guilt through the sacrifice that Jesus made for us on the cross. And so John the Baptist understood who Jesus was. He was the Messiah who would come and die for us. So how does John the Apostle present this relationship between John the Baptist and Jesus here? Obviously, there was a close relationship. They were, but John the Baptist, even though he was a superstar, knew that Jesus was the Messiah and was greater and humbled himself. As he said earlier, I must become less and less, and he must become more and more. And that's what we see John the Baptist doing now. He's humbling himself, he's becoming less and less, and making Jesus more and more. Let's look at verses 38 and 39. Jesus looked around and saw them following. "What do you want?" he asked them. They replied, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "where are you staying?" "Come and see," he said. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon when they went with him to the place where he was staying, and they remained with him the rest of the day. And so John's disciples in this passage began following Jesus from a distance. And Jesus turns around and he confronts them. What does Jesus ask them? "What are you looking for?" Or in this translation, "What do you want?" And I think that is a significant question, not just for Jesus' disciples, but for each one of us. For you, what are you looking for? What do you want in life? It's a question that we really struggle with, don't we? What is your purpose? What is your meaning? What are you trying to obtain? These are the first words of Jesus Christ in the Gospel according to John. And so I think that this question is significant for each one of us. The very first words we get Jesus asking, "What are you looking for?" So let me ask you what you are looking for, and keep that question in mind as we go through this today. And what was the response? "Rabbi, where are you staying?" Or basically they were saying, "Can we spend the night with you? Wherever you go, we want to stay with you," is basically what they're saying. And so what do you notice about their response? First of all, they refer to Jesus as rabbi or teacher. I don't believe they fully, completely comprehend that Jesus is the Messiah at this point. And this is one of the themes we're going to see throughout the book of John, is that the belief of the disciples increased over time. We're going to see, and then they believed. And then a couple chapters later, we're going to see that the disciples believed again. And then a couple chapters later, they believed again. It's not like, oh, they stopped believing and now they're believing again. It's that their belief, their faith grew over time with Jesus. Just like with us. You know, we may have a little bit of faith, but over time, our faith increases more and more as we understand who Jesus Christ is. And so that's exactly what we see in the Gospel according to John. The apostles, the early disciples, their faith increases little by little over time, and they believe. But right now, we can see that they're in their infancy of their belief. They really don't know who Jesus Christ is completely yet. And that's okay. That's okay. Jesus is a teacher, but more than a teacher, Jesus is God. Have you ever heard someone say that Jesus was a good teacher, but they didn't really believe that he was the Messiah or the Son of God? You know, the famous English Oxford scholar C.S. Lewis, who wrote the books, the Chronicles of Narnia, including The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. I don't know if you've seen the movie, but he was the author of those books. He was a Christian at the University of Oxford. He said, you know, that it's not possible for Jesus to be a good teacher and at the same time teach that he was the Messiah, because that would either make Jesus a lunatic or a liar or something worse, because a person who believed they were Messiah and was not the Messiah was either crazy, or they were a liar, or they were something worse. They were something evil. So you can't really say that Jesus was just a good teacher and at the same time not believe that Jesus is the Messiah. It's one or the other. If Jesus can only be a good teacher if he is the Messiah, because he claimed he was, or he's a lunatic, a liar, or something worse. But look at this statement here. Jesus doesn't push them away for not having enough faith. He says, he welcomes it. He says, "Come and see." What are you looking for? Jesus is inviting you. Come and see. Even if you don't know what you're looking for, even though you don't really know, Jesus invites you to come enter into a relationship with him and just explore who he is. He's not afraid that you're going to find something out, because he knows exactly who he is. He's the Messiah. So come and see. Come and see. That's what Jesus is inviting you here to do. Let's look at verse 40 and 41. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of these men who heard what John said and then followed Jesus. Andrew went to find his brother Simon and told him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. So Andrew was one of John the Baptist's disciples, one of the two that got sent out by John the Baptist. So we see Andrew and John the Apostle. After listening to Jesus for a while, he went to go get his brother Peter and said, "Hey, guess what? We found the Messiah." So we see that they go from calling him teacher to Messiah. And so we don't know how much time has passed. Andrew then brought Peter to Jesus. So first, Jesus is like, "What do you want? What are you looking for?" And then he says, "Come and see." And they came and saw, and they believed. And then Andrew went out and got his brother Peter and said, "Come and see." So now, that is how Jesus calls us to live out our faith, to make disciples of all people. So Jesus disciples the apostles, the early disciples, and then they go out and they get more disciples. And then the movement grows. That's how Christianity grows. And so he brings Jesus to Peter to Jesus. So something obviously changes between the time Andrew left John the Baptist and went to go find Peter. There's something obviously that changed in his faith. John is the only author in the gospel accounts who refers to Jesus as the Messiah. All the other gospel accounts refer to Jesus as the Christ. The Christ is from the Greek, Messiah from the Hebrew. Christ means anointed one, and basically means is referring to the Messiah. But because John is writing to Jewish people, he uses the term Messiah rather than Christ, like all the other gospel accounts do. Basically means the same thing. Let's look at verse 42. Then Andrew brought Simon to meet Jesus. Looking intently at Simon, Jesus said, "Your name is Simon, son of John, but you will be called Cephas," which means Peter. So Andrew brought Peter to Jesus, and we see something that happens in this passage. Jesus changes Peter's name from Cephas in Aramaic to Peter in Greek. Both the Greek and the Aramaic means the rock. And so Peter's nickname was Rock. Where have we seen God changes people's names in the past? God changed Abram's name to Abraham. God changed Sarah's name to Sarah. God changed Jacob's name to Israel. So God changes people's identities. And that's a symbolic of what's happening in the spiritual realm. God changes your identity too when you become a believer in Jesus Christ. No longer are you whatever you identify yourself. Now you become a child of the Most High God. And so what we see here is that Jesus is acting like God, because Jesus, we have seen, is God. And so Jesus changes Peter's name as a sign of authority, gives him a new identity. John is trying to get the Jewish listeners to realize something. Jesus has the character a whole lot like Yahweh in the Old Testament. And the reason why is because he is a whole lot like Yahweh in the Old Testament. He is the Son of God. He is the eternal Logos sent from heaven, who took on flesh and became human. And so he has the power and authority to change your identity. No longer do you have to be identified with your sin, whatever your sin is. Now you can be identified with the Most High God. And that is something amazing. Let's look at verses 43 through 46. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Come, follow me." Philip was from Bethsaida, Andrew and Peter's hometown. Philip went to look for Nathanael and told him, "We have found the very person Moses and the prophet wrote about. His name is Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth." Nazareth, exclaimed Nathanael. Can anything good come from Nazareth? Come and see for yourself, Philip replied. As they approached, Jesus said, Now here is a genuine son of Israel, a man of complete integrity. So, Jesus went out and he found another disciple, Philip. And what did Philip do? He went out and found Nathanael. So we see this pattern. Jesus goes and makes a disciple. That disciple goes out and makes another disciple. He goes out and gets Nathanael. There must have been something really special about Jesus. When you got into his inner circle, what was he like? There was something that really magnetized people to him. Because after these men had only spent just a little time with Jesus, they went out and told others that they found the Messiah. Philip knows his Bible and refers to some prophecies in the Old Testament that looks towards the Messiah. One, you can look these up on your own. One is found in Deuteronomy chapter 18, 15 through 18. And the other is Isaiah chapter 9, 2 through 7. Isaiah chapter 11, 1 through 12, and Isaiah chapter 53. You can look up these three chapters on your own and study them, but these are three chapters that point forward to the Messiah and what he came to do, the suffering servant found in Isaiah 53. Nathanael was not sure about Jesus. Nazareth was found in an area of Galilee and was a small town of about 2,000 people. It was kind of like the armpit of Israel. It'd be like saying the next U.S. president is going to come from a small town in the hills of Kentucky or the hills of Tennessee. And Philip said, well, come and see for yourself. Exactly what Jesus had told to Andrew. Come and see, Andrew and John. So basically we see, are you curious about Jesus? Jesus invites you to come and see. This is what Jesus said to Andrew and John. Come and see. What do we find here when we find Jesus? That's a great question for you. What are you going to find when you find Jesus? Don't be afraid to look. And then in verse 47, in this verse, Israel's name before God changed it was Jacob. And Jacob's name means hill grabber or a deceiver. And his sons were a bunch of spoiled, rotten, no good guys if you read about them in the book of Genesis. With the exception of Joseph and Benjamin, integrity was not a word that we would use to describe Jacob and his sons. Jacob's name means deceiver. So Jesus is making a pun or wordplay when he says, as they approached, Jesus said, Now here is a genuine son of Israel, a man of complete integrity. What kind of person do you think Nathanael was before he found Jesus? Probably somebody who did not have a lot of integrity. Jesus is making a judgment about Nathanael, and he's allowed to do that because he's God. He can make those kind of judgments. Let's look at verse 48 and 49. How do you know about me, Nathanael? Jesus replied, I could see you under the fig tree before Philip found you. Then Nathanael exclaimed, Rabbi, you are the Son of God, the King of Israel. This translation says in verse 48, How do you know about me? The better translation is, you don't know me. You can't judge me. That's really the attitude that Nathanael has in this passage. Have you ever heard somebody say that? You don't know nothing about me. You can't judge me. That's basically what Nathanael is saying. And Jesus' response is interesting. He says, I could see you under the fig tree before Philip found you. And so it shows that Jesus has supernatural insight. He saw Nathanael doing something under the tree. Nobody knows what Nathanael was doing under the tree, but that's not relevant. Whatever he was doing under the tree was significant for Nathanael. And Jesus saw it. And so whatever it was that Jesus saw Nathanael doing, and it was significant for Nathanael, made him a believer, a true believer that Jesus was the Messiah. He says, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God, the King of Israel." Just by what Jesus said, something significant that he saw in Nathanael. And let's look at 50 and 51, the last two verses. Jesus asked him, "Do you believe this just because I told you I had seen you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than this." Then he says, "I tell you the truth. You will see heaven open and the angels of God going up and down on the Son of Man, the one who is the stairway between heaven and earth." Basically, Jesus tells Nathanael, "You ain't seen nothing yet. You thought that was amazing? Just wait. You're going to see even greater things than that." That's one of the themes we talked about in John, how John talks about greater and greater and greater. Jesus is greater than, and also that we will see greater things coming out of Jesus. John focuses on those greater things to come. And this is one of the first verses of the greater things to come. We saw a little bit with John the Baptist. He must become greater and greater, and I must become less and less. And so remember, Jesus referred to Nathanael as the son of Israel. Jesus refers to himself as the stairway or the ladder. So Jesus told Nathanael he would see heaven open with angels going up and down on the Son of Man on this ladder. And what is significant here is that Jesus is continuing that wordplay from Genesis, Jacob's ladder in Genesis. Jacob was spending the night in a field, and he had a vision, and he saw heaven open, and there was a ladder, and there was angels ascending and descending on this ladder into this gateway into heaven. Jesus is saying he's the gateway into heaven. He is the ladder. He is our access to heaven. And so you can look that up. It's Genesis chapter 8, 10 through 17. And again, Jesus is identifying himself with Yahweh, the I Am here. Let me just say, I don't know where you are in your faith with Jesus Christ today, but I always say God's a lot closer than what you believe. He's right there next to you. And if you haven't given your life over to the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can do that today. God is only one prayer away. All you have to do is confess your sins. We've all fallen. We fall daily in thought, word, and in deed. We repent from our sins. That means we turn our backs to our sin, and we turn towards God. And we ask God to come into our lives and to give us strength through the Holy Spirit to help us overcome sin as the blood of Jesus has freed us from sin. And so I just encourage you, to, in the words of Jesus, what are you looking for? Come and see. Come and see. Don't be afraid. Come and see. Come join us. Follow us around. See what we're all about. And for all of you who are in the faith, I encourage you to go out and make disciples around you. That's one of our missions here in the world, is to make disciples. To go out just like Andrew Dunn and the other ones and tell their friends, come and see. It's about multiplication. Let me close this out in prayer. Father God, I just give you praise and honor and glory today. You are amazing, Father. We love the things that you are doing in our lives. We love that we can come before you and not be afraid. We don't have to be afraid to come into your presence, Father God. And not only that, that through your Son, Jesus Christ, you welcome us in. You welcome us and to have a relationship. You say, come and see, Father. We just thank you for having that special access that you've given to us. You are a good God. You are a loving God. And we just give you the praise and the honor. We just ask that your presence will be throughout the world this week, Father, and we just ask for a special blessing over the people of Ukraine right now, that you will give them special protection as they are in the throes of a horrible war, Father God. We just thank you for what you have already done. I know you have done tremendous miracles, and you are a miracle worker, God, and we believe that you can do great things, Father, in this part of the world, Father. And we just ask for that to be apparent, Father, and just send your presence through the Holy Spirit over the land and anoint the land, Father. We just pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. All right. Thanks for coming to Virtual Chapel. We'll see you next week. God bless.